Welcome to this session today. We are live on not only on Zoom but also on Facebook and Twitter. So welcome everyone. If you have questions during the session, please feel free to post them on the respective channels, and we'll try to consolidate those questions and answer them as we go forward. So these are really unprecedented times, and marketers in particular across most industries are impacted. So what we have done today is that we have put together this power-packed panel of these awesome tech marketers, and we will discuss some of these challenges as well as tips for building a MarTech stack for a post-COVID-19 world. So hello folks, we have Dipali Nair, she is Director of Marketing India and South Asia at IBM. We have Gaurav Mehta, Chief Marketing Officer at CarDeco. And then we have Piyush Kumar, who's head of data platform engineering at Make My Trip. Welcome, folks. I'm a big fan of your work and feel honored to be moderating this panel. So let's start with a basic question, right? Obvious question. How has this current crisis impacted you, in particular your marketing initiatives? And what are your key strategies in terms of people, process, and tech going forward as the situation unfolds? Can I request Dipali to go first? Dipali, if you don't mind.
Thank you, Apoorv. Thank you, first of all. Thank you to the Exchange for Media team also. And I know that people are watching us live on Zoom and Insta and Facebook and Twitter. And your question is that how has life changed? And how will life change going forward? Okay. Every marketing team, and not just the marketing team, but the sales teams also. And I do see sales and marketing going hand in hand, especially in a B2B, marketing setup like we have at IBM. We've had to pivot. We've had to be very agile in terms of, shutting down a few things, evaluating a few things which were working for us in the pre-COVID days and is continuing to work for us. So keep them on. And also do a simultaneous stream of saying, okay, how will we come back post-COVID, whichever be that life stage, how will we come back? So let me explain, right? So for example, I'm part of the Asia Pacific team, and at Asia Pacific, for example, we have, ANZ, we have Korea, and, we have the ASEAN countries, and we have Singapore. Everybody is in a different life stage in terms of coming out of COVID. We see Korea and ANZ, for example, coming out sooner, compared to India. Right. And there, the thinking therefore is that when we are coming out, what is the kind of conversation that we want to drive with our audiences, and how do we want to reach out to them as a responsible, conglomerate? Right. So that's the kind of work that's happening over there. Right. In India, for example, last 5 weeks for us has all been about supporting the clients that we have. So we are supporting essential services. There is no telecom company in the country that we're not supporting. There is no banking organization in the country that we're not supporting. We are part of the BCP planning for example, for RBI. All the digital payments that you see happening in the country, some part of it or the other is being touched by IBM, right? So a lot of the work has not been in that marketing domain so much to speak for ourselves, but from a marketing perspective, but it has all been in the in the communications and in supporting the client space. So we are running things like help hours and things like those, right? And then if you look at the core marketing work that we have, right, we used to have a combination of a lot of digital marketing and a lot of face-to-face marketing. And of course, two channels that we had. We've of course had to completely stop the face-to-face work that we were doing, right? And we've had to find channels there to see, okay, how can we convert it into digital? The digital marketing work continues, but there the content and the messaging we've had to pivot very quickly and change it because the same messages are not relevant any longer. So there's been a lot of content change that we've done over there, right? My team, for example, has done a lot of virtual events now, very experienced in doing webinars. I was just talking to Piyush and Gaurav in the pre-session, tons of webinars. But I must compliment the teams at IBM and specifically my team who were already thinking of doing a lot of virtual work this year, even before COVID hit. So we actually did a very large 3,500 people virtual forum in the month of Feb when there was no COVID anywhere, around, because we know that the world is changing. So I think the evolution, was in any case into the non-face-to-face formats was happening everywhere in the world. It's just that I think COVID has perhaps accelerated that effort. So Apoorv, with that, Piyush or Gaurav can take on from there.
You made that very good point that you're pivoting from physical to more of digital channels. How is it for you, Piyush, for the online travel industry? Do you see the same things, or what are your observations there?
No, so ours is like the worst hit, like industry per se, travel industry per se. But yeah, everybody is like hit in more or less in different formats, etc. But kind of changes with respect to what Dipali shared, right? In our context, it would be very different per se. Yeah. So it's not just because of industry, channels, etc., but in terms of our interactions with the customers per se. Earlier, like the kind of interactions which we were focusing on was either more transactional or conversion related things, but now we are primarily focusing our efforts around engagement platform, etc. So engagement becomes the key, and knowing some of the initiatives which we have done in past, primarily onto personalization and understanding of customer, etc., are helping us like so do a better communication and conversations in this time. And obviously, some of the other things, which is like now building the safety first product, is more important in terms of communicating rightful things in travel, right? So Make My Trip being the industry leader and a super app kind of thing, we have like different line of businesses, right? So starting from flight, hotel to holiday packaging to, we have newly launched initiatives either on experiences, activities, and MyWiz sections, etc. And we are hoping, right, these things would get a different shape with respect to the efforts which we are making primarily on the engagement side of it. And the other key part is like, so some of the other things which internally we are working on is like, so we are making sure like, so as the phase-wise approach, which Dipali also alluded to, right? So, and saying, okay, when we come back, right? Or like whatever shape the business is going to be back into, how our approach with respect to either content, communication, or like with respect to business is going to change, right? So in the hindsight, if you think, right? So business is going to come out like a rebooted operating system. Yeah. Right. Yeah. So where there should be a new software installed, and that's what we are trying to build in these times and hoping for the best, yeah, going forward.
Okay. Cool. Gaurav, what's your view been like? Are people still searching for cars as much as they were doing before? How has that changed?
So short answer to that, Apoor, lesser for sure. Less people are searching for cars. But what we are seeing, there's an interesting insight that's coming out, is that there's a surge of user interest in used cars. And that's a very good thing to see, because used car, if you see, used auto is a very disaggregated, fractured ecosystem. And it's not digitized, it's not owned by a single player or like a number of players. It's very, very ad hoc. But we are seeing that people have started searching much more for used car. And I think it might be coming from the fact that people will be a little bit wary of taking shared mobility options like your Uber and Ola or even metros and buses, at least for the foreseeable future, just because of trust and hygiene perspective. So I think used car, the entire adoption of used car as an industry, or digitizing of used car as an industry, has just accelerated a lot. Will accelerate a lot. I think what we are seeing right now is the user interest, and because of which I say what I say. The second part is April was the first ever zero revenue month for Indian automobile industry since the time the automobiles started in the country. So can't be more unprecedented than that. But again, what it has like done is that by looking at the potential car buyers and two-wheeler buyers, the OEMs, all the big OEMs have started to look at digitizing much more seriously. I think earlier there was a little bit of an ad hoc effort that maybe, okay, chalo, digital marketing देख लेते हैं, ये कर लेते हैं, बट देन डिजिटाइजिंग द बिजनेस ऑपरेशन हैज जस्ट कम टू द फोरफ्रंट ऑफ अ लॉट ऑफ बिग ओईएम्स. हाउ कैन वी मिनिमाइज फिजिकल इंटरेक्शन? हाउ कैन वी डिपेंड अपॉन टेक्नोलॉजी टू वेरी फ्रैंकली टेक द कंज्यूमर प्रीटी मच थ्रू आउट द एंटायर ट्रांजैक्शन फनल एंड सो ऑन सो फोर्थ. सो as the largest autotech company in the country, our job has been what we wanted to do has been accelerated by the current situation. So I think there's some while on the in a short term, in the near term, I think there are bleak scenarios like for Piyush also. I don't think people are going to be traveling in May and June, the summer vacation, which is their peak season. And I think we are not also going to be seeing a lot of uptick in car purchase or two-wheeler purchase, be it new or used. But I think in the longer run, this is the reset button that is going to digitize the entire industry very, very rapidly. So I'm very, very optimistic about what the future holds.
Yep.
Yeah. Okay. So all of you are on the same page when you say that this is going to accelerate marketing technology, so as to say, right? So what are the key marketing technologies that each of you see coming up or evolving for each of your verticals? So maybe you can start this time, Gaurav, if that's okay.
Sure. There are 2-3 things, specific to my industry. Maybe I can just talk about it. One is that the transaction, any technology that is enabling transactions, even for a product like cars, is going to get like supercharged. We are seeing a better traction, not just from our side, but even from the OEM side. I think Hyundai, MG, Kia, Maruti, all of them have launched their book cars online modules, and they're fairly aggressive about it. And we are also like leading that whole thing for our users. So I think that piece of business will see a huge investment from a technology perspective. Second thing, Apoor, what I'm seeing is that people have understood that the fake news is a real and present danger. How do we like really get the right information as and when we want it? And it's not just the publishers or the news media which is responsible for them. I think for stronger brands, consumers will start reaching out to them directly to understand what's the right thing or what's the wrong thing about the industry and about the brands that they own. So even the whole communication aspect of the business from a CRM perspective will see a huge uptick. And maybe the third thing is, since all of us have been sitting at home for the past 40 odd days, there's no sense of time, day part, and so on and so forth. I think if at 12 in the night you want to check out something, you will check it out. So how can you be available 24/7 and not be like, be from 9 to 6 kind of a thing? So the call center support in the traditional manner, I think that's going to be obsoletized fairly soon. Your chatbots and your self-help modules, I think they will see a big uptick fairly soon, because I think people are going to be demanding information and the right information fairly quickly. I think these three business aspects of business will see a huge uptick from a MarTech perspective, a technology perspective.
Okay, that's a good point. So before I move to you, Piyush, there is a question for you, Gaurav. Would the focus be on new or used cars post lockdown? What will be the change in eyeball strategy? So this question is by Manas Mohan on Zoom.
Okay, thanks for the question, Manas. I think very quickly I'll just try and answer that. New auto was fairly digitized, at least when it came to ad tech. Yeah, not maybe mart tech, but ad tech. Yes, used auto, it was like leagues apart. So I think a lot of focus is going to be on used cars, because I think that's a huge opportunity area for us. If you look at from a macro perspective, till about this last financial year, new auto was growing at about 6-8%. New auto, used auto was growing in high teens. It is the year where used auto transactions were more than new auto, whereas in value terms are a bit lesser, but then in terms of transactions much more. So I think the time has come to really structure and digitize the entire used car economy right now. And that's where our focus is going to be.
Okay, thanks, Gaurav. And I'll come back to you about MarTech and AdTech, but that will be a separate section. So Piyush, what are the key technologies you are seeing evolving or becoming more important in a post-lockdown world?
Yeah, not just like so related to marketing per se, right? But the whole customer experience with respect to process automation is like where we are focusing and doubling down our energies and efforts onto. And the second part, as Gaurav also mentioned, right? So the chatbots and like, so we have Myra, which is our chatbot. And hence, like, so understanding and answering all those kind of things, because like, so when this unprecedented thing started, right? So like more or less, right, everything was either getting canceled or like, so people are just calling our call centers and bombarded with like, so all kind of either refund cancellations, requests, etc. So we saw a massive surge into those kind of queries, apart from like the normal informational queries per se kind of thing. So whatever automation, etc., and making seamless in terms of customer experience is something which we are really working on. Okay. The other part is like, so utilizing the whole data-driven automation, right? In the MarTech, whatever you want to call it, right? So it's really, we are focusing on two things, right? One is like really understanding the customers, how better using some other like angles which we haven't looked at. When things were good, right? So you know, okay, everything, we are focusing more on like what users are searching for, this, that, and all. And then hence building on some of the trends which are already pumped into from the data or the signals which are already generated thereon. Right now, like, so because like, so that has dipped, and hence we are like right now forced into looking at various other signals and aspects of like what this customer has done or doing, not just in terms of like, so the user activity or device activity per se, but in terms of, right, how can we seamlessly build some of the components or just to tell the audience itself, right? So MakeMyTrip invested onto building our own stack internally itself last couple of years itself. And we are trying to build things on top of it, right? So we invested on building a feature store internally, and then sitting a customer data platform on top of feature store itself, which is not just powering the machine learning models, but internally also leveraging some of the communication related stuff which we are doing through various channels of push notifications, SMS, and email.
Okay. Dipali, how about you? And not just, I'm looking at you not just from IBM perspective, but also from some of your clients' perspective.
Absolutely. In fact, I was going to say that to you, Apoor, that this one question can get actually keep me going for 30 minutes, but I won't do that to you.
No, please do that.
Okay, so let me just break it and put a framework to this, okay? I want to refer to the three trends that Gaurav and Piyush mentioned. Okay, one is Gaurav very rightly pointed out the whole call center ecosystem will undergo a change. The way they need to be, the way they need to support, and the technologies therefore that are required. So especially the AI-enabled, you know, call agents and chatbots are going to become really prominent, and we are already seeing a huge uptake on that and conversation on that. I'm going to be launching a campaign in a few weeks' time to actually start talking about that, because that needs to undergo a change, and that's undergoing a change. The second thing that Piyush spoke about, which is the whole customer experience bit, right? So every single big organization that we're engaging with is rethinking the customer experience, right? They are talking about how to sell in a post-COVID world. And the interesting thing is that it's no longer a marketing expertise or marketing domain. It's no longer the CMO's headache. The CEO is asking that question to the CIO, and that's the interesting bit. And that's where the marketer needs to partner the CEO and needs to partner the CIO in ensuring that the customer experience is different in the post-COVID world. And there is no technology stack that they're not thinking about. So, you know, be it AI, be it blockchain, be it, you know, MarTech, AdTech, you know, integration. They're talking about all of those stats. So these are two things, these are two trends that I picked up from these guys. But apart from that, one of the things that one needs to look at is that, you know, the whole world is going to be a very data-led world. And there is going to be a too much data that's going to be available to us. And there is a thing called the ecosystem is going to become very important. It's no longer going to be about data that gets used, that gets generated by me and gets used by me as an enterprise. Okay. It's going to be about what kind of secure data systems that I have that I can share it with my ecosystem for the ecosystem to become strong. And how do I do a data exchange over there? And that's the new world that people need to think about. Okay. So AI already spoke about. Data security, therefore, will also become a huge concern. And it's not going to be a concern only of the CIOs once again. I think every business head who is, you know, dealing with data, utilizing data, generating data, it's going to be responsibility, you know, of those guys also. It's going to become very important for the brand reputation to ensure that there is data security, right? And blockchain is another thing that I want to talk about. This is a personal thing. This is not necessarily an IBM point of view, but this is Dipali Nair's point of view that I think in the coming world, the kind of transparency that blockchain, you know, is able to provide, the work that we're doing in the space of food trust, just as an example in the US, is going to become very critical. And I see a lot of work happening in the blockchain space. It may not happen in the next 6 months, but I see that changing the way we do business, in future. So that's on the technologies that touch marketers directly. But there is going to be a lot of technology change in the organizations about movement to cloud, for example, right? So this whole on-premise versus off-premise thing is going to undergo a huge paradigm shift, right? And that is where movement to cloud will become, accelerated. At IBM, we are very, aggressive, and we are very confident, and we've done a lot of things in the cloud space, and the conversations, it's not going to be only about cheap cloud or fast cloud, it's also going to be about secure cloud once again, you know, and I can tell you that, we would like to say this, IBM cloud is the most secure cloud and most reliable cloud. So I think those are the kind of conversations that are going to happen. You asked me, about what's happening with a client. So I've kind of summed it up. And I think the other lens that we need to look at is the industry. So there's going to be some industries where the movement will be very fast in certain spaces. So for example, in the manufacturing space, supply chain is going to be an area that's going to be re-looked at. We're seeing that already. It's going to be looked at very quickly, right? In the financial services domain, the data security, movement to cloud, the off-prem, on-prem, and the customer experience. These are all areas that the financial services will look at, right? Education is going to undergo a change. And the other thing, don't forget, governments are going to relook at the processes all over again, right? And there's going to be a lot of investment from the governments to relook at what's happening, with the population. I don't want to use the word consumer, but the end consumer living in the country. So yeah, I've kind of painted the horizon. Yeah. For you here.
And I think we'll probably see a lot of hybrid cloud strategies as well, not just on and off, but mix of both.
See, hybrid cloud is here to stay because for the next few years, people are doing movement, right? We are investing in the country. IBM offers private cloud and public cloud. So it's going to be a combination of that. And depending on what the organizational stance is and where they are in the life stage of their movement and how quickly they want to move, we're going to be seeing that.
Right. Okay, cool. Thanks. So I'll come back to ad tech questions about advertising, etc. So Rohit Mohan has asked this question and a few others have also asked this question. After lockdown, it's going to be a phased opening, right? It's not going to be all opening in one shot, right? And that probably has an impact on your media and advertising strategies and how the MarTech world will play with the ad tech world. What are your thoughts on that? Who wants to go first? Gaurav, maybe you? Want to take a shot?
Sure. So I think, as I said, right now, I think rather than being proactive, I'm cautiously being reactive. That's contrary to how I would have liked to play. But then right now, I'm being reactive on this one because of the industry that I represent, which is automobile. I know for a fact that it's going to be like really low on the pecking order for the next 2 to 3 months as people also come to they realize, what's their disposable income levels are going to be like, what is it that they want to do with the money that they want to spend. So for me, it's more about a consumer behavior that will translate into the ad tech or martech decisions that I'll take. But as of right now, I'm reacting rather than trying to take the bull by the horns.
Fair enough. Being reactive probably is a good strategy, right now. Piyush, how about you? How do you see advertising and media and all of that playing around with your MarTech strategies?
So one of the key things is obviously, we are very like closely working with the CRM teams primarily, right? So I'm part of the technology team who is working on building and supporting most of the campaign strategies right now, which they are doing. But like, so for, there was a question which I saw on a Q&A section, right? Do you have a strategy for a phased approach? This, that, all? Yes, we do. And there are like, so on a very high level, right? So phase 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, this is how we have divided. And the key part here is like, so as Gaurav and you both mentioned, right? So it is not going to go full blown up sooner, right? So at least like, so this year it is going to play like more or less like, so only essential travel or some of the things are going to open, etc. But again, like, so continuing to the thoughts which Gaurav said, right, reactive in terms of, right, what users have already started doing, right? Like picking up the trends from what they are doing, etc. And the other is like, so as government has announced, most of the data sets are available now with the COVID-19 data sets with red, green, orange kind of labels of every district, this, that, and all. So we created our data sets in terms of location, right, stuff, what is green, what is orange, etc. And we are trying to understand those destinations, number of cases, how their number of deaths, etc. And trying to correlate those things with the data patterns internally about historical trends of those destinations which we have. And trying to see, okay, where we can enable some of the campaigns, where we cannot, etc. So, and hence, like, the core part is to really match both the data sets closely and then work with the whole team as one, right? So we are debating and launching some of the new stuff as well. And I hope, like, so you guys are going to see, which is very unlike Make My Trip kind of thing. But yeah, definitely we are experimenting with lot many things now. And then it's, again, like, so experimentation is going to be the key going forward, right? So, and you need to see what is getting stuck. So think about like, so like every startup, right? What they will do, right? They will experiment something, and then whatever is going to win, or like, so where you see a light, right, coming in, and then you go after it, right? So
right.
That's how our reaction or reactive approach is. But experimentation is going to be the key.
Okay. Okay. Thanks. Look forward to trying out some of those experiments, Piyush. Dipali, does this phased approach, phased opening, and the overall uncertainty, does that mean that you have to continually change your or evolve your marketing strategies, and do you plan for that, or can you plan for that?
So I think if you are a smart marketer, I think your marketing processes need to be built for the fact that you will need to pivot and change. Okay. And my segmentation may not be geographical, like Piyush spoke about, and his business requires it to be geographical, right? Mm-hmm. In my business, segmentation is about the, like the way I mentioned, industries, right?
Right.
The government and the manufacturing and the financial services, right? And that's where my segmentation comes from. And I think the difference that has come in, and I completely agree with Gaurav and Piyush what they said that, but I think I just want to add on a layer there. I think the difference that has come in for me very importantly in the last few weeks is the way we look at content. Okay. In B2B, for example, all of us are used to saying this is a thought leadership content, and the tactical content was, you know, not the thought leadership content. Let me just put it that way. Okay. But I think the difference now is the way the consumer is consuming that content has made us relook at what we dole out as tactical stuff. Okay, it's no longer tactical. We have to really look at what we are saying to them. We have to look at, you know, messaging and say, okay, how can I give more relevant messaging to the smaller segments that I have? One of the changes, for example, you know, we had a brand campaign that we had just launched, but we've gone back to an older brand campaign that we had because that's more relevant during COVID times. Okay. So I think those are the kind of things. And I was speaking to a lot of my CMO friends. A few of them in the first 2-3 weeks really struggled because they said, listen, you know, I mean, media is available so cheap and so on and so forth, but what is it that I put out? You know, I have to really get the content out. But I think now Right. Everybody is come around that, and we're all doing the needful, which is required in terms of changing our messaging quickly, and that means changing the content. But that thing on ad tech and martech, of course, continues. The stack and the segmentation and the customization, and therefore this content piece becomes very important in the personalization space.
Okay, excellent. Okay, so my next section is about metrics. But before I come to that, Piyush, there is a specific question for you from Saif Ahmed. He says, how is MMT using CDPs or customer data platforms in this situation? So first, are you using them, and what's your take on those?
Yeah, as I said, right? So we build our own customer data platform internally on top of feature store itself. So we know as part of our customer data platform, we have user master, device masters, their booking history, etc. And then we build various data sets on top of it, right? A user is transacting into a funnel, right? Be it flight, hotel, ground transportation, bus, rail, cab, etc. We internally do the stitching of our trip per se, right? So a user is not particularly booking an itinerary or a trip, right? He's buying most of the products individually into the different funnels per se. And we try to understand how the customer is now traveling from point A to point B. What, as a super app, because we have other products, what can I cross-sell, upsell, do all those kind of things. So customer data platforms are utilized into those kind of things. Now, historically, we have these data sets, right? So now we are utilizing these data sets to better understand, right, what they were doing pre-COVID era, right now, what they are trying to do, etc. Are they doing any searches, etc. The other key part is, right, so we have a section called Trip Ideas, right, which is heavily onto content side of it, and hence trying to push users to engage with the kind of content which is available on the platform itself. So, and that now what kind of themes or categories or tags you want to focus and utilize onto, and what communication you want to do, and what content to share on the feeds in Trip Idea section per se is utilized based on whatever transactions they have done, right? Have they traveled more on adventure side of it? Have they traveled or onto those kind of things? And hence, content play based on the transactional data is something which we are heavily working on right now. Yeah. Okay. I hope that answers.
Thanks. That's a good overview. Hopefully, that answers his question. Okay. So coming back to the metrics, right? So I want to look at metrics from two lenses. One is, we all know that investments are going to increase. We all agreed that investments in digital marketing are going to increase. But it is often a very tough task to actually justify a business case for a MarTech investment. So do you use metrics to justify a new MarTech investment? For example, can you measure increase in CLV or LTV and attribute to a MarTech investment? So that's the first lens. And the second lens that I want to look at it is what are the key metrics that you track or you think are important to track for each of your businesses?
You want me to go first?
Sure, Dipali, go ahead.
Okay. So I will tackle your second question first. Okay. At IBM, we really believe on the performance marketing side to track the ROI on my investment and track it to sales. Okay. So there are variables that we track in between, which is, let's say pipeline, leads, value of deals, and so on and so forth. But ultimately what matters is that, has that gotten us the sale? And I used to have the same philosophy when I worked at Mahindra Holidays, and I learned the same philosophy when I was the e-commerce head at L&T Insurance, right? You put in the money, ultimately, if you're doing business and if you're managing a profit sheet, if you're managing a business, then that's what matters. And that's what we do at IBM. We also do the brand health monitor. We also look at share of voice. We also look at brand relevancy, the traditional matrix that marketing teams have been used to looking at. In between, my campaign managers will also look at engagement rates. They will also look at click-through rates and all that, because those are all input variables that will deliver the numbers to us, right? So that's you know, your question number two. I think your first question is more interesting for me, which is what will happen in the future and what are we looking at, right? So there are of course, the customer lifetime value is a metric that we were already looking at. It's not that, you know, it has come into the picture only at COVID. I worked in financial services for 10 years. Customer lifetime value is a concept that is there to stay in financial services, right? The only thing is that AdTech, MarTech were not married to each other in terms of the processes that marketing teams used to run, right? And that marriage will perhaps, I think, you know, is going to be the holy grail that we're all going to chase, right? My worry and my question is more for the customer experience side of it, right? So if, for example, customer experience is measured, let's say NPS, and everybody used NPS as a score for measuring customer experience, right? Now, the question is, 1 point increase in NPS, okay, contributes to how much extra sales in the long term. That's a metric that we don't have, okay? And the second metric that all of us don't have is what kind of investment in what kind of technology stack will give me that 1 point increase in NPS, right? If we can solve this equation, you know, we'd be living in a perfect world, but all of us are in a life stage of where we are trying to solve this problem, right? How much investment, what effort, whether in technology or in marketing, do I need to make to increase my NPS? And that increase in NPS, is it translating into sales? You know, to me, the world will go around trying to solve this equation. I'm going to just leave it there.
Okay.
Yeah, I think Dipali makes this a very, very strong point, especially what she was just like saying at the fag end of a chat right now. This stitching together of a consumer journey from, say, research, product experience, consumer experience leading to transaction, leading to cross-sell, repeat-to-repeat transaction, that's still in silos. And I don't think without having a very robust SCV, a single customer view, can you actually start to understand the tangible value that your ad tech or martech is bringing in for the business? Yeah. Let me just like bring out an example. So I'm like, we are in the business of selling and buying cars and motorcycles in the country. About 25 million people buy and sell cars or bikes in the country. Yeah. Versus about 290 to 300 million unique users who come on our platforms in a year basis. So only about 10% of our, even if I were to think that each and every person who's buying the car or bike is on our platform, only 10% of my user base would be actually transactors. So first thing is for me to understand which one is going to be transacting and who's going to be like repeat transacting also. So, and that's an ad hoc silo basis right now. So if I'm getting a new user on my site through ad tech enabled technologies, how do I sell maybe an insurance to that person a year down the line and ascribe the same value to this person? Ki bhai theek hai, this guy was brought at a dollar value last year, but now he's giving me $10 right now. He gave me $5 last year and so on and so forth. I think that stitching together is super important. That can only be enabled through single customer view once you have that. So that identifier is super, super critical because you have so many platforms. You have mobile web, you have PWAs, you have mobile apps and all that. And the identifiers don't go horizontally.
Sure.
And just to give you an example, why this is such a potent force, we launched our used car retail stores last year where a person could just walk in and sell their cars at the retail store. Now, we didn't have any first party data on a person who wants to sell the car in the next month or week or fortnight and whatsoever. We just dug out our old database where people had given us the consent and where they bought a car from us 4 to 5 years back. And we obviously knew that 4 to 5 years later is when a person changes the car. So we use our own data platforms to personalize the journey, to intervene at the right time and have them be interested in selling a car to a retail store. And a lot of that data worked, those intelligent interventions worked. But that's a very ad hoc effort. And that's the point that I'm making. So while I acquired this guy 5 years back, I again made some value on this person at some point in time last year by cross-selling him. But then is that going into my CLV or LTV calculation right now? Mm-hmm. As much as I would like to say yes, it's not happening because my SCVs are not robust. My single customer views are not robust. Once that is enabled, then I think this is a foregone conclusion that LTV will be the first thing that each and every person looks at, because it can be enabled then robustly.
Right. So this whole single customer view and stitching together profiles from devices and channels is an interesting area. Are you using any off-the-shelf technology for it, or are you building all of this on your own, like Piyush has done?
Yeah, so we're building this on our own. We had acquired a company about four and a half years back. It's called Connecto. It's a big data platform.
Okay.
Where we actually track a lot of journeys. And once a person signs up with us, that's the unique identifier. But then that's okay. A fraction of the entire 300 million odd unique user base. So while, I'm like, we will have a good number of data in absolute terms, but in terms of percentage wise, it will be still lesser. So you can assume that like our best foot forward can only be put forward for that percentage whose journey we can stitch across the media.
Right. Obviously. Yeah.
And then it's easy for us to like make the LTVs on that. But what about the rest? Huge population where we don't have an SCV.
Sure.
That's my point.
Okay. Deepali, you were saying something?
No, I just, you know, while you're talking about it, I just remembered that in the pre-discussion, when we talk about change, one of the most important element is bringing that change into the organization, and that means people. And I particularly remember one incident which I was discussing, with it. So Piyush and Gaurav have heard me, talk about it, that when I joined, one of the organizations, and the KPI there for the marketing team used to be cost per lead. Okay. And they would deliver fantastically on cost per lead. And, when we're discussing this whole customer lifetime value and customer experience and NPS, the shift that I wanted to make there was that just move from cost per lead to cost per sale. But then what happens is the sale gets impacted also by the sales team. It's not just being done by the business team, but just by the marketing team, right? And when I announced that shift, I lost half of my digital team because they weren't happy, about it. And I also lost my agency. I had to hire a new agency also, okay? So these changes don't happen very easily. Change is a very difficult process to implement, So when you're doing a tech stack change, when you are doing KPIs change, when you are doing new ways of working and new ways of looking at how you're going to be, scored at the end of the year and appraised at the end of the year. These are not very easy changes.
Absolutely.
That's the thing that's going on in my mind, that, we're very easily talking about the changes.
Sure.
And I think my compliment to lots of teams and agencies and businesses during the COVID period in terms of how they've shown agility, and actually move to change.
I agree. Change management is often more trickier than technology and other things. That's a good point. Okay, so Martech guru Scott Brinker released his humongous landscape map last week, right? And that graphic reinforces the notion that Martech is not only rapidly evolving, but is becoming complex, very complex, right? So do you agree with that one? And how do you cope up with this ever-evolving MarTech landscape? Do you have research teams in place? How do you hire people? Do you train people? How do you handle all of that rapid evolution? Who wants to go first? Any volunteers?
Gaurav, we're discussing it in our pre-discussion, remember?
Yeah. Gaurav, go ahead.
No, I'll give a quick point of view. I think, again, this whole thing, I'll be the first one to laugh if anybody says ki I'm like a subject matter expert on the entire stack of MarTech. I'm definitely not. But at least I try and understand what it can bring for the business. I think internally how we try to like remain as updated as is possible with this ever-changing is that there's a mandate for the consumer-facing teams to huddle together to understand what are the real consumer problems that are company is trying to solve. Yeah. And I think it's upon the marketing and the product teams to really rank order these problems. These three problems where the person is looking for maybe a certain color variant at a certain locality in terms of the car that he wants to buy. But right now we don't have the knowledge or we don't have the information to actually provide that to the consumer. And then we proactively try to either build it out through our own data platforms. And if not, then we try and like hire that. But the only problem in that particular issue is that it's too fractured. it is not coming out from the right architecture. You don't have a platform in which you just put like Lego pieces and it just builds out together. Maybe these are parallel streams that start to emerge together, and that's the biggest problem. That you might have a really robust platform for one facet of the business, but then the other might not be talking to each other. And that's the biggest problem that one faces. And I think the change will come from the consumer-facing organizations, functions within the organization. And I also include the customer support team into that. And so what we do is we almost have a pod structure to this, something where we try and see which are the main problems to tackle. And then there's a conscious effort to see if we can not, if we can't build it out, then let's just hire it. But consolidation is a big issue.
So just continuing to what Gaurav said, right? So I'm not sure if this analogy is going to fit to this context per se. So clients, think about like client server and peer-to-peer kind of thing in customer relationship kind of a setup where think about clients are consumer applications or customers, etc. And then server is something which is a central brain where you understand a true MarTech setup where any interactions, etc. is understood by that central brain or brain or the server. And then based on the good understanding of the customer, etc., you are just maneuvering the customer experience and the journey forward, right? In a true personalization manner. And the other piece is the plenty of tooling, stack, etc., which you alluded to, is making sure things are disjoint, and then you need to build more of a peer-to-peer technology, which is going to be really chatty, right? So because and everybody needs to talk to each other to make a single view or whatever view you want to call it. So my only submission to is you need to see, as Gaurav said, right? You need to see where your organization is into what kind of journey, what you have already built, what you understand internally, which is everybody says, right? So we have our own MarTech space, but what you understand internally with respect to a customer and what the ecosystem understands about your customers or the footprint they have done, right? So, and how seamless. For example, some of the mappers, et cetera, which we talked about, right? So the smaller issues, right? Which is having just identifiers, common identifiers all across is a pain, right? And just maybe not right now, but a year ago, I would say just a simple ask of just saying, okay, you can't communicate it two times in a week to a customer is going to be a pain in the ass, right? So in saying, okay, here are three different tools which I am using, etc., and they don't talk to each other, there is no central thing, right? So my only submission to is have a view of a client kind of or client server kind of a setup where the central brain really understand, or whatever you want to call it, be it a customer data platform or whatever, right? Understand that thing. And if the technology and stack is stitching together like a Lego-like component, etc., that's the way forward to think about it.
Okay. Dipali, any thoughts on that?
Nothing to add here, but I'm just saying that the practical limitation that a marketer and an organization faces sometimes is that we don't exist alone and we don't have all our processes in-house. Different companies have outsourced the processes to a lot of marketing vendors, be it advertising agencies, media agencies, or other content providing services. And I feel that the ecosystem is not rising up and changing the speed at which sometimes, let's say, organizations such as Make My Trip and Kardeko are changing, because they're doing development of stack, in-house. And we do it at IBM also, by the way. Our stack also gets developed in-house and is very advanced. And I think sometimes the limitation comes in from there, because it's a reality. You can't take all, aspects of marketing in-house.
Right. Okay, good points. So let's talk a bit about the dark side, right? So both of you, Gaurav and Piyush, you mentioned stitching together of profiles and merging or enriching first party data with second party, third party data and all of that stuff, right? So all of that is good, but it also has implications of data privacy and consent management and all of that. So how do you made or have you implemented any safeguards? We don't have a privacy law in place yet, right? So what do you guys do for doing all of that?
Yeah, so it's not like, so data privacy law is not kind of a mandate, but it is still in draft state or whatever. Sure. It is. And like, so at least from industry perspective, we were involved like other partners in the industry as a voice, like while the process was on for the draft itself per se. And then hence and internally to the organization itself, right? So we internally kicked off many projects and which are more or less live now, which is either in terms of data anonymization, having UUIDs in place of any PII information, etc. And we cleaned up all the data sets, etc. all across. That was a massive, massive effort. And the group CTO took that call because like, so this is not going to be a conversion impacting project or which feature which you are developing internally to enable some of the things. But like taking privacy and data security as the key thing, not just like be the person in terms of just doing the data capture, storage, and doing the analysis and then doing building the data products per se, as Dipali in her earlier thoughts also shared, right? So data security is going to be the key going forward, because like, so one glitch is going to give you like a bad name, bad brand name, or whatever you want to put it out there, right? So, and we keep on seeing across the industry, there are things or hacks, etc., which are building up. But just coming on to the other part which you said, right? The first party data, second party, third party, or alternative sources where you gather data through, etc. And it's not just like, so having our own thing cleaned up, right? You need to work with, as Dipali was saying, right? You need to work with all your partners in the ecosystem, etc., to make sure, like, so because customers are giving their footprints and leaving good amount of PII information on those platforms as well, not just yours, right? And if they are your customers and they are coming in from those channels, you need equal amount of trust with respect to how they are handling those kind of things. And I really hope, right, so the data privacy bill is going to pass soon, hopefully next year or so. So that, like, so at least, like, so the core part in the bill is, right, so customer is going to be the owner of whatever the footprint he is leaving behind, right? And most of the things are either seeing or learned from GDPR, etc. And here, the core focus is with customer, and when customer becomes the custodian of his footprints or his trail, etc., organizations are then forced to take out all those measures, etc., which is going to be into a very good thing.
Okay. Okay. So, is let's say if I were to tell Make My Trip to forget me and not track any of my customer journeys or interaction, is that ever going to be possible?
Ever, yes, but like it is going to be really, really hard. It's not going to be easy in near future per se, but yeah, there are things which we are working on. Some of the things are already done, like having a central vault where this PII information, etc., rather than spreading across all the data sets, mapped to some of the UUIDs, etc., which are doing those references to the central vault, right? So we have prepared those services. We are doing the good amount of work on fraud per se internally as well. So we are leveraging some of the stuff which we were working on, fraud related stuff, along with the data security and privacy kind of thing. But not yet. But yes, definitely that's the way. And it is going to be really, really hard in saying, okay, just forget about me, right? Yeah, or clean my shit, whatever you
are. Okay, good to know that. So Gaurav, you want to go next?
So I will add to what Piyush is saying. I think from a tech perspective, what he just spoke about, anonymization and so on and so forth, that's an ongoing project with our side also. There are two aspects to the whole data privacy thing. One is obviously legal and compliance, which is maybe, I think Piyush rightly pointed out the kind of steps that are being taken. I'll also point out the relation between a business and the consumer. a large part of data privacy is not just about being only legal and compliant, which is obviously a very, very large thing, but also what kind of value are you adding to the consumer? I've always seen that consumers are open to giving their own data and their consents if you are giving them the requisite value back. And that's the consumer experience aspect also that we at Kardeko are a little bit cognizant of. How often or how are we using the data that the person has consented to share with us or with our partners also? Very quick example, if a person wants to buy a Hyundai car, are we selling it to, say, a Maruti dealer? No. So that I mean, the trust of the consumer and the user experience is also not like sacrificed just because we want to monetize that one lead multiple times. So I think the other element of consumer privacy is also like the consumer experience.
Right.
Are you into short term of revenue buffering up, or are you like building a business which delivers value and then people say, you know what, I like what you guys give me. Here's my consent. Here's my data. Okay. That's the second part apart from what Piyush spoke about.
Okay. Dipali, you did mention data security earlier, but do you want to add on here? Any further thoughts?
No, nothing. I don't want to add on here. And also just wanted to remind you, I think we've got only about 5 minutes.
So I've been taking questions on the way. So I think we are towards the end of our time. So before I summarize, I'll take one last question, which is really a top of mind question, I think, right now. Any guesstimates on how long it will take to get back to pre-COVID scenario in terms of demand? This is a question by Narayan Ganeshan, but I think everybody wants to ask this question. Anyone?
Nobody knows that answer, yeah. Truly speaking, right?
Make a wild guess.
No, Apoor, also I think it depends industry to industry, right? Sure. Food essentials will come back to normal far sooner than I would say fashion, okay?
Right.
So I've just picked up two random.
Yeah.
I don't think it'll be the same time period for everyone.
Okay. Very quickly, my industry, if it comes back in the next 4-5 months, I'll be happy guy.
Yeah.
Okay. So those are good statistics. Okay. So let's see. So there are several other questions, and I apologize, I cannot take them all right now because answering them would take a lot longer than what we have. So we'll just close it here. Thank you, everyone. There were some good points about how MarTech will evolve and what are the different challenges that we have to address. We talked about AI, data security, privacy. We even touched the dark side of all of this. So that was a very good discussion. Thanks also for some great questions from the audience. You were awesome folks. Thank you. So we'll close this discussion right now. And if there are any other questions, we will try and see if we can answer them offline. Yeah.
Sure.
So thank you, Dipali, Gaurav and Piyush.
Yeah, I have a plug to do. We have a very, very big event happening today. Arvind Krishna, who's our chairman, is going to be doing a keynote at 8:30 today. I'm going to post the link on my Twitter. Anybody can sign in. It's one of the most premium, most events in the technology companies. You want to know more about technology? Please attend the event today and tomorrow. I'm going to be posting it on my Twitter. A lot of you are anyway, are on Twitter. It's at 8:30 p.m. today. Guys, join in.
Okay, cool. Yeah. Any closing thoughts, guys?
Yeah, just be creative. So humans are creative. So apply your knowledge and like hopefully this shall also pass and then whatever is going to come is going to be good for good, yeah. So be safe, that's it.
This shall also pass, yes.
Yeah,
that's good.
I really think let's not be too tough on ourselves.
Yeah,
but things are not happening as rapidly as they used to be, so the effort is not giving the right result. I think that benchmark is gone at least for the next 2-3 months.
Yep,
let's be a little bit easy. When I said I'm being reactive, that's what I meant. That let's look at the new consumer behaviors, new industry truths, how they're emerging. And then try and leverage and then give a creative solution. I think Piyush, bang on. I'm going to be creative. If we are just too hard on ourselves, don't watch your brains for the next 2-3 months thinking like that. And stay safe. That's the paramount thing.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good point. So thanks for those points. And thank you, everyone. And thank you for all those who attended. Have a good evening and stay safe.
And thank you, Apoor. Thank you for asking us all these lovely questions. Thank you. Good night.
Thanks, Diwali. Thanks, Gaurav.
Thank you, Abhiyush. Bye, Gaurav.